Okay, we are now live. I'm just waiting till 4 o'clock, but oh, it's 4 o'clock now. Perfect. Welcome everybody to our Women Ed International Women's Day webinar. And who better than to have Sue Cowley, our I'd like to call you a patron really, of Women Ed, and we'll talk about why in a minute. But welcome, Sue, to Women
Thank you
Ed
very much. It's
International
lovely to
Women's
see you,
Day.
Jules.
Thank you. I do need to say how wonderful your hair looks, because mine is lockdown hair, and somehow, Sue, you've managed not to
I
have
timed
lockdown
it
hair.
right.
Tell us your secrets.
it's all in the timing, Jules. As they say in life, it's all in the timing. I just managed to get it done.
I just turned up with purple hair, but you know, hey. So Sue, I wanted to start a massive welcome to you. And
Thank
like I
you.
say, I feel that you're the patron of Women Ed, because when we started out, you were our first keynote. And wow, I mean, what you must look at Women Ed and think, wow, the impact of my keynote has just made Women Ed. It's the first book, it's the second book with being on the front. So I wanted you to tell us about it a little bit, really. Just let's remember it and discuss it. What did you think when you were first invited to come to this new Women Ed thing in London?
Well, I thought it was amazing, Jules, and I thought, oh, this sounds like fun. And then I didn't actually get round to writing my speech until the night before. So I'll tell you the story in a moment.
Excellent. And so we invited you to come along, and it was the first time I'd met you. I'd obviously heard of you, and I was a little bit sort of like, wow, Sue Cowley and stuff. But you were, I think one of the things I wanted to talk about with you today really is just how sort of down to earth you are, really. I mean, you know, but you are quite a big name in education, and you know, you've written books, and you're big, and you're very, but you're a brilliant speaker, but you're incredibly down to earth as well, and I think that's kind of possibly one of your magics about it's choose
Oh.
to challenge, isn't it? So, and you know, one of the magical bits of you is that you're very down to earth, and yet you're a huge influencer.
Oh, bless you. Well, my other half is very useful at kind of keeping me sort of pinned down a bit. And if I get a bit kind of, oh, I'm an author, he'll go, don't get too up yourself. There's nothing special. And he's right, I just because I write books, it doesn't make me any different to anybody else. It's just I happen to be lucky enough to do that, and people seem to enjoy reading them.
They
So
do, and the generosity as well, because obviously, you know, your career is speaking now and writing, and yet your generosity to come down and do that keynote for us as well. We were all incredibly grateful. Tell us about that though. So what did you decide? Say, okay, I'm meeting a group of women in London to talk about leadership. So, I'll turn up with some fluffy handcuffs.
you want to hear the story, don't you?
Yeah,
Well,
tell us the story.
it's quite a long story, actually.
It's fine. We have plenty of
So,
time.
yeah, I thought, seeing as I'm going up to London, I might as well go and see my best mate, who lives just south of London. She lives in Carshalton. And I thought, oh, from there, it'll be perfect. So I can get the train to Victoria. And then the keynote, the event was sort of in Victoria, wasn't it? And it also happened to be my birthday the night before. So the 2nd of October was my birthday, and the keynote was on the 3rd. So I basically went and had a bit of a session with my mate. And I confessed to her that, I hadn't written my keynote speech, which I was meant to be delivering. So we got rather drunk to celebrate my birthday. And we were talking about this concept of 10% braver. And I actually got it from my best mate, whose name is Elka. And she said to me once, she came home from a training event, and we talk about these things because obviously she knows training is a big part of my work. And she said to me, oh, I just did this training event. And the lady on the training event said something really good. And she said she'll share it with me. So she said, the lady said to me, what would you do today if you were 10% braver? And then you should just go and do it. And I thought, that, there you go. That's perfect. That's serendipity, isn't it? So I thought, I'm going to bung that in my Women Ed speech. because it just kind of, the quote just kind of caught my attention. And actually, I think it does kind of sum up the way I live my life. I was talking to one of my teenagers earlier about this, and I do just kind of tend to just go, oh, well, I'll have a go at that and see how it pans out. Oh, I'll have a go at that. So it's this thing really of, you know, taking leaps. And I think in my chapter in the first Women Ed book, I talked about this. And it's this idea of being brave enough to take a little leap. It's not a big, huge thing. So anyway, we got quite drunk. We wrote my speech together. I woke up the next morning severely hungover. I don't know if you realised on the day.
No, you covered it very well.
I said to my mate, I want to chuck in some jokes. So she had this pair of handcuffs and I kind of borrowed those and incorporated those. And then when I was doing the speech and it got towards the end, and I said, I'm going to read out this song. And then it was like, sing it, Sue. That was Vivian, wasn't it? I'd just seen her just down there.
Yeah, no, Vivian's
here.
She
made me sing it with a hangover, Jules. There you go. But that's kind of the story of where it came from.
Yeah.
My best mate, who actually, she's so cool. She rides a motorbike. She works for the NHS. She's a clinical trials nurse. But she rides a motorbike. She has leathers. You know, she's one of those people that you just, the first time I met her in my early 20s, I just,
And does she know now that she's sort of on the front of our book?
Does, yeah, I've told her.
We must get her to come
and talk. She's completely blanked it out of her mind that she ever told me that quote. So she's like, I don't remember telling you that.
Well, we are very grateful, because I think, and do you know what? I think she needs to know that so many people have gone into leadership positions because of that quote as well. I mean, just it's just like the nudge you need, isn't it? To, you know, 10%
the
brave.
The power of it. Yeah, I think it's just fantastic. Hit a chord, didn't it, really?
It really did. And the question about the fluffy handcuffs was from Vivian, just so you know, Vivian. She wanted to know.
I won't go into too much detail there.
So so we feel like we know you really well, but you know, because of your work in education, but give us a little potted history of your time in education, because you started as a secondary school teacher, didn't you?
Well, kind of. It's quite complicated. I didn't go straight into teaching. I actually left school at 16. I was one of these, I would have lots of labels attached to me these days, because I was from a single parent family, I was on free school meals, all that stuff. And so I left school at 16 and I went to train to be a professional dancer, of all things. And then I kind of got injured. So then I had to come into a new career. And I chose teaching partly because my mum was a teacher and I always had that kind of, you know, keep it in the family. And I went and did an early years teaching degree. But while I was doing that, I got really into my subjects, which were English and drama. So I did a 4-year teaching degree. So it was kind of English and drama and teaching alongside. And I got so into the English and drama thing that I sort of thought, oh, I really want to teach my subject. So I kind of made that leap into secondary to just, and again, it's that thing of just going, oh, what the hell, I'll just give it a try and take a punt and see what happens. And I think often that's where the best things happen to you.
Yeah.
So the best things that have happened in my life is where I've kind of gone, what the hell, I'll just give it a try.
Yeah. You know?
So I went and taught in secondary schools in London, because I'm originally from London. You might kind of pick up, although I've been down in the southwest for a long time.
Oh, you've still got that London accent. It's like people tell me I still got my Kent accent.
You can't get rid of it, can you? And then I went to teach again. This is another taking a punt. I think I included this in the keynote. My other half came home from work one day. He worked for Virgin Megastores. And he said, oh, they want to open a new megastore in Lisbon. Do you want to go and live in Lisbon? I was like, oh, yeah, that sounds like fun. So we went to live in Lisbon. But while we were there, I obviously applied for teaching jobs, but it didn't start immediately. So I had a bit of time on my hands. So that's when I wrote my first book. So then I kind of taught overseas for a while, then came back and taught in London again. And then we moved down to Bristol, where I've done sort of various things and ended up back in early years where I started. So, but yeah, it's quite random, really, Jules.
Yeah, I know. And the earliest thing I think is where I see you sitting now. I know I always think of you as very experienced. But it is very interesting because I think your book, your famous book really, the one I always knew you from was Getting the Buggers to Behave. And I think it was a secondary school teacher that was very we were at the Festival of Wellington, I think, and I was chatting to you, just walking down as you do with Sue Cowley, and my colleague went, "Oh, that's Sue Cowley." And she went, "Oh, it's amazing. I can't believe you know her and everything." And I was like, Yeah, she's a friend, you know, she's just been to my session of dyslexia, you know, that's who I rock and roll with. But anyway, she said, she went, "Oh, she changed my life." She says, "I used to have really poor classroom management. I was really struggling with behaviour." And she was in a, you know, a London, a rough London school that she loved. But, and she said, and she read your book and it completely changed things for her. And so, although you're writing now about your learning behaviours, that
I have one of those too.
It's very similar, that first book, that it changed, you know,
This
secondary school
one.
teachers' life. That's the one.
I got a big pile of books in my
It's
study.
fine, yeah, get them all out, get them all out. But it really changed it for her. So what prompted you to write it?
I wrote it actually not too far from where I'm sat right now in a little rented cottage the other side of the village that I live in now. And I had, as I said, I'd been overseas and taught overseas for a while and came back and taught again in London. And I was in a very sort of challenging secondary there. And then we decided to make the move out of London because we couldn't afford to buy property, basically. And basically, I left the school and I sometimes say I kind of vomited this book out. I literally wrote it in 6 weeks. I literally sat down in that back bedroom and just kind of went and out it came. And so it was almost like a summary or a reaction of all the experiences I'd had to that point. So I think, and I'd sort of come out of this situation where I'd taught in one school and found it quite easy, and then gone to another school and sort of found it almost impossible. And I thought, well, hang on a sec, you know, what am I learning here? And can I reflect on, you know, what went right, what went wrong, what these different contexts that I've taught in have taught me. So I think that's kind of where it came from. I didn't actually think up the title myself. That came from my editor at the time, a guy called Anthony. And he said, "Would you write a book called that?" And I'm like, "Well, as I said earlier, I'll give it a
Give it a go, but it is the title. I know sometimes I've heard people say it's a bit disrespectful, but it is. I see it in the I hope in the spirit it was meant, you know, that's what we sort of say in a jokey way, isn't it? And you know, I think it, I love the title, and it's very catchy, and it's kind of, I think it's one of those things that when you're struggling in the classroom and you go back to, oh yeah, thinking about the buggers, let's think about that book and remind myself how to do that classroom management stuff, isn't
Yeah,
it?
I often think about the title, and I do think I can see people's point of view on that. And
Yeah.
probably if they did a new edition, this is from 2014, I would probably say, look, you know, we should look to change the title. But obviously, they haven't asked me to do a new edition. But I think to an extent, I've often sort of thought, you know, was it just successful because of the title? But actually, it's been in print for 20,
Yeah.
almost 20 years now.
Yeah.
And I've had a lot of people sort of spontaneously say to me, you know, your book really helped me. And so
Yeah.
there must be something in there that just connects with
Oh,
people.
yeah.
But I
Yeah.
think at the time, there wasn't really, I mean, that was my second book. My first book was this one. This is the one I wrote in Portugal, How to Survive Your First Year in Teaching, although it's had a few editions now. But at the time, there really wasn't a kind of practical texts like you get now. So
Yeah.
almost we were flying, you know, flying blind. We didn't, you know, there was nothing else like it on the market at the
Yeah.
time.
And you are really that original, because I think now lots of people are writing books, aren't they? And we're seeing loads coming out, which is great. It's really good advice for teachers and practical. But you really are the original book writer. You know, when we think of Twitter now, with all you know, people come on Twitter and get followers and then write a book. You're the original, aren't you? You know, that must be really quite nice to think.
It is. I tell you what's really nice, Jules, is to think that they're still in print, because that's quite unusual.
Yes.
I mean, this is from over 20 years ago, the first one.
And it's still relevant.
Yeah. I mean, obviously you update them when you do new editions, but I kind of think there must be something there that that rings a bell with people. And that's the main thing, really. I just felt at the time there weren't any books that described the experience of being a teacher as I recognised it.
Yeah.
So I thought, well, you know, why not?
Yeah. And is that theory versus practical, isn't it? Because like you say, sort of being able to recognise, and also because you're quite self-effacing, I suppose, and you write well, you're a good writer, aren't you? And, you know, I know you talk about this a lot, but that idea that it's when you read something that sounds simple, it's actually taken a long time to write. So more complex writing is almost easier, you know, and you write very clearly with humour, and it's very relevant. So I think that's what people take away from your books. Do you do that on purpose?
Yeah, one of the things I think about being a writer is it can become quite self-indulgent, and you can fall a bit in love with the sound of your writing. And so I always try and sort of think to myself, you know, is this actually going to be useful to my readers? So it's not about me and what I want to say. It's about my readers and what will help them. So, you know, when you're thinking about, you know, how do I structure this? You're kind of looking for something that's going to be accessible to people who don't have lots of spare time, basically. So, you know, it's quite rare really to have the opportunity to sit and read a book all the way through. So I do try to make them a little bit, you can dip in and...
Yeah, dip in and out, which is really useful, isn't it? Because, and again, that's quite interesting, that idea of writing to help rather than for people to hear your voice. There's a slight difference, isn't there? A bit like talking to listen or talking to tell.
Yeah, exactly that. Yeah. You know, you just want your work to help people.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
because that's absolutely how you get readers.
Yeah, exactly. So tell us about this one then. So you've talked about your first book there, and we've got Palm coming as well. We've got some women ed people to come and join us to say hello to. So this is your new book. Tell us about it.
Well, basically, Jules, I like to write about what I'm doing at that time, because, you know, as we've sort of been saying, my writing arises out of the things I'm experiencing. So because for the last, I mean, everybody on Twitter thinks I'm just early years, you know, the idea that actually I taught quite a long time in secondary is, but I don't talk about secondary on Twitter because I'm not in secondary at the moment. So because I've been helping to run a preschool for 10 years, I've kind of got back into that kind of, you know, what happens at the start and how does behaviour develop over time and what do you need to get in place first? So it's been really interesting kind of going from, you know, get the bugs to behave, which is really a kind of, you know, practical manual, to this one, which is all about, you know, how does behaviour develop in young children. And also it kind of reflects the way I've changed a little bit in my thinking about behaviour. I think the biggest thing that changed that was becoming a parent. I think you see schools and teaching quite differently when you've got children of your own and when you hear their view on it. So it's just a very practical book. It sort of takes you through all the aspects of the development of behaviour, starting with behaviour is communication, and sort of going on through, you know, I look at environment and the impact of environment on behaviour. I look at curriculum, I look at relationships and so on. And then there's a really handy chapter in the back, which is a case studies chapter, which is kind of what the book grew out of. I'd written these case studies, which are very, very specific. You know, what do I do if a child bites? You know, it's not something you have to worry about in secondary, although maybe.
Well,
So again, it's just a very practical book aimed at early years people. So
thank you for that. Right, so this is where I go all controversial now. So, and I mentioned that word.
That's not like you, Jules. No.
I'm trying to behave. I'm trying to behave as the new me. No, it's not really. Ofsted, okay, particularly the early years at the moment. So I have noticed a big push to make early years more formal in Ofsted. And so I'm kind of imagining that people are thinking, oh, stick them all in rows and make them learn their phonics and handwrite. I also noticed that you are out in the forest a lot doing forest school. So what have Ofsted got right and what have Ofsted got wrong in your opinion with this new framework?
There's a question. I mean, we've actually been inspected under the new framework, which right. was a very interesting experience. I won't talk about it in detail. But anyway, what have they got right? I think they have tried, I will give them this, they have tried to get away from all these kind of myths that have arisen. But unfortunately for them, they seem to be giving rise to some new myths already. So I think it's just part and parcel of the whole accountability thing, really. I think, you know, in a way, it's good to think about, you know, curriculum as the basis. But one of the issues you have in early years is curriculum is a totally different thing. You know, curriculum is about a child's overall development. And one of the things that worries me, what I'm seeing, is where people are trying to link the EYFS to the national curriculum. So they're mapping out their curriculums and they're going down the year groups and they get to early years and they go, oh, tell us how your thing fits into this. And it doesn't fit in because we don't have the same areas. And one of the things about early years is not that many people necessarily have experience in it. So they don't understand how different it is. It's taken me really, it's taken me the whole of the decade to get to grips with how different it is as a phase. I mean, obviously I originally trained 30 years ago in early years. But since then, there's been a lot of developments. I mean, there's been a lot more understanding about early child development. So I think it's the understanding of it as a very separate phase. But then you've also got this thing with Ofsted where they've now got two frameworks for early years. So they've got a framework for PVI, which is private, voluntary, independent settings. That includes childminders, daycare nurseries, preschools like the little preschool I helped to run. And then you've got the schools-based early years framework. So I think what we'll actually see is it's going to kind of go like that. Because one of the things about early years is the government don't actually have many levers over us because we take fees as well as funding. But they do have levers on schools. So I think we're going to see a bit of a split, and I think they're trying to kind of push reception off kind of to one side, which I think.
And I hear you talk as well about that it's not compulsory.
Yeah.
You know,
it's a non-compulsory phase.
Yeah.
If they wanted to, parents could send their child to you in, you know, the term after they turn five, if they wanted.
Yeah.
I mean, they don't, because that's how it's all structured now, and you start in reception in September and so on and so on, and you've got your funding, but they could.
Yeah.
And, you know, so the experience should be such that it kind of replicates the home, really. You know, it's not an academic thing. It's a learning, care and development thing.
Yeah. And certainly from somebody that comes from a big, you know, language, belief in language, oral language, then it's a lot of language, isn't it? You know, rich vocabularies and...
well, something I say, which is kind of a joke, but actually we spend the first 5 years of our children's lives trying to get them to talk and desperately worrying if they don't. And then we spend the next 15 years trying to get them to shut up. But it's so true, isn't it?
It's so true. That's really
two,
interesting.
Like a parallel universe sometimes.
Yeah, it's really interesting. And the other thing that which I like about the idea of the forest school as well is that and this was told to me by somebody in a pupil referral unit for so primary school children that get excluded. And she was talking about this one particular child that really didn't talk a lot. And it was often linked to sort of experiences. So they spent the first, you know, good 6 months with this child going to the park. So actually they had things to talk about. So if, you know, I'm always interested in that idea that if we're going to keep them doing just very small things like phonics and sitting at desks and stuff, then have they got things to talk about? And, you know, so experiences. So it's linking those physical movements often, isn't it?
It is. Language. And I think we spend a lot of time in education talking about, oh, children from advantaged homes, ... But then we fail to actually think about what we're saying about what children from advantaged homes.
Yes.
And it's exactly what you're saying. They have the experiences. They have traveled. They have been taken in the outdoors, you know. Yeah. And that's not necessarily about money.
No.
But often money allows you to have the time to do those things with your children if you're not having to work, you know, three different jobs to make ends meet.
But
I think we talk about advantage and disadvantage, but I think often we're maybe not really thinking through what we're saying. You know, trying to stick on extra vocabulary, as you say, if a child hasn't had the experience, they won't retain it.
Yeah, and it doesn't, or it's, you're forcing them to retain it in a way that is really boring rather than, you know, who wants to learn about paddling if you can't paddle? It's like, go and paddle and they'll learn the
word. You're down by the beach.
Yeah, exactly. I am advantaged in that way. So, we know we agree on a lot. We're probably being told off now because we agree too much. But let's talk now about, so International Women's Day, which is today. And the hashtag this year is Choose to Challenge. And so not only were you perfect for today because of Women Ed and you're bringing us 10% braver, but you also do challenge, as we've discussed a little bit with Ofsted. But you do it in a way which you don't get intimidated by people, but also I think you do it in a way that you don't offend people either, so you don't become personal, so you stick to the substance of the debates no matter how contentious it gets.
Carry on, compliments.
How do you do it? Because I just want to know how you do it, because I get really intimidated now by people.
I think, you know, the thing about social media is I think you have a choice, really. You can either let it come at you or you can grasp it and take it and make it what you want it to be. And I've kind of started using this phrase, which, hi, Samina. Samina's saying hi in the chat. I started using this phrase, which really kind of rings a bell to me, which is that nobody has the right to your attention. And I don't know if it's a female thing. Maybe it's slightly the way we're socialized, but we don't want to kind of push people away. There's this kind of feeling that there's something wrong about that. And I think I've built around myself a protective layer so that, you know, the people who I don't want to speak to don't get my attention. And then I think also I've got my motto, Jules. I think you will probably remember my motto. Am I allowed to swear in this?
We do it all the time. Although I remember once Vivian got told off because she got a bit tipsy and started swearing and people's children were watching, but hopefully there's no children watching. So yeah, close your children's ears right now because Sue's about to swear.
So, well, it's not a big swear word, to be honest, but my motto is, I think you're mistaking me for somebody who gives a shit. So it doesn't hurt me. I have got used to, you know, having my work reviewed, being critiqued and so on, because obviously I've been writing for a long time. And when you're a writer, you send your book out and some people will hate it. And that's absolutely fine, because I don't have to allow that through and to dent my confidence. So I'm basically, I respect your right to have that opinion, but I actually don't give a shit, because I have a sense of, it's a kind of, an inner confidence in what I do that doesn't, it doesn't really arise out of, it's like you were saying earlier, I'm not a kind of boastful person really. But it doesn't arise out of that. It doesn't arise out of thinking I'm great. I just kind of know that it's okay. And I know I'm saying what I need to say. But I think you have to, it's very difficult for teachers and people in those kind of roles, because you have to think about, you know, who's looking at what you're saying online. Whereas I can go online because I'm kind of essentially work for myself, and I can be honest and I can challenge the DfE and I can challenge Ofsted, and I honestly don't give a shit, you know. I mean, I don't want to upset them. Well, you know, I don't really care, but you know, I can say it as it is. I don't like spinning stuff. That is how it is. I'm going to say it.
Yeah, and that and I think that's the perfect thing about challenge, isn't it? Because challenge is a really nice way of it's a great word, actually. The more I think about challenge, it's a great word, because it isn't insulting, is it? But I am going to challenge you, and I can challenge you, and that inner confidence you talk about is, I think people often that get upset about criticism probably aren't that confident, maybe, or, you know, there's a sort of, probably if you were writing, I don't know, if I were writing my first book, maybe I would not like that, you know, I would get upset about the criticism possibly, but that would be a confident thing.
It's horrible being criticized. But you have to toughen up. Otherwise, you're not going to write another book.
Yeah, there's no point in writing. Yeah, you can't be a writer and have everybody agree with you all the time, can you?
Well, you don't have the right to
to
force other people to have a particular opinion on stuff. It's just, you know, if enough people like it and buy it, then it's been successful. So, you know.
Yeah. So if you were choosing, if there's one thing you were choosing to challenge at the moment, what do you think it is? What's the most important thing that you would choose to challenge this year?
I think this year we have seen the deep impact of inequity in society. And I think this pandemic has laid it bare. It's absolutely laid it bare. And I don't think that it's covered enough in the press just how, you know, the level of people with learning disabilities who've died in the pandemic, the difference between people from different groups who've died, you know, I mean, it has laid it bare, and it has basically, you know, that's what needs challenging. And this is the thing that, this is why I don't feel bad about giving the DfE a hard time all the time, because they're trying, it's a spin, you know, oh, fill the gap. We're just a bit of tutoring. The gap is caused by the way society operates. And, you know, a little bit of spin and a bit of extra tutoring or making the school term longer, that's not going to resolve it. You have to get the equity in the first place.
Yeah, it's a good challenge. And I think the that whole narrative of the catch up is tricky with that, isn't it? Because, you know, certainly from me working in special needs and being very passionate about exclusion, you know, what is quite interesting, what the language we're hearing now, that it was like nobody gave a monkey's last year when I was talking, you know, when we talk about all these children.
Are you going to
school.
Send your children home because they haven't got the right shoes when, you know, they've children, just been out of school?
Or they got the wrong hair, or, you know, yeah, I know. It's quite interesting, isn't it, that sort of, you know, I mean, I work with families and have done, and particularly during the general election, I chaired some Dorset panels with all the MPs, and they were from SEN, so they were in SEN schools often. And the stories were just breaking my heart of these, this was before the pandemic, and the stories were breaking my heart of these families that were sitting there and their children hadn't been in school for a year or 2 years, and it's like nobody seemed to care, and suddenly they didn't have remote learning
all of a sudden.
And these children, I think, were the most vulnerable and the ones with the fewest resources available to them, and so I think it's a good thing to challenge.
It's been interesting, hasn't it, how SEND parents are saying, well, you know, this is our everyday experience pushed out. And probably one of the things that I'm most pleased about in terms of our setting is that we are truly inclusive. We will truly move mountains so that your child or your child will be able to access us. We will change our provision in order to be accessible. And I think that for me is probably the proudest thing of what I've done maybe in the last decade, is made it possible, you know, not said, oh no, we can't cater for your needs.
Yeah.
Although,
yeah.
you know.
Yeah. And that for me has been one of the most toxic things about, you know, there's brilliant multi-academy trusts and things in the world. But one of the most toxic things has been to hear schools saying, if you don't like us, go to the school down the road. And we're like, when you live in Dorset, there's not an option. You have to go to that school. You know, you might be able to do that in London.
but we don't have any tubes.
There's no choice here. You know?
don't have a bus once a week.
Yeah. And I'd like, my chooser challenge would be to bring back that pride that, like you have, of being saying that we are to be proud to be an inclusive school, not proud to be at the top of the league tables. You know, that's that pride is, and you can be excellent as well as being inclusive. That's the thing as well. Like your, I'm sure your early years provision is. So, has the DfE ever approached you for behaviour advice?
When I saw that question,
you're so experienced. Yeah, I know I'm probably being a little bit naughty, but you know, you're really experienced. You've been writing books for years. Like you say, they're still in print. So, you know, you think, oh, who would I contact for a bit of advice on behaviour for my new for the DfE? So have you ever been approached?
No, and I wouldn't expect to be because I choose to challenge.
Wouldn't that be a good thing though? Wouldn't it be good to have a diverse group of people in the DfE and in the Ofsted challenging each other?
This particular government isn't interested in speaking to people who aren't going to be on the same.
Yeah,
you know, for all the talk about, oh, it's all about evidence and so on. No,
only one time
they have an ideology.
Yeah, okay, that's a shame, isn't it though, because actually I'd like to think if I ever, not that I ever am going to become, but if I were ever you know, Minister for Education, that I would want actually people that I disagree with around the table. But yeah, you know, for me, I think that's a good thing, to be challenged, isn't it? We should be
welcoming. I did apply once for one thing. There was an Ofsted thing where they were having like a forum for people who were involved with settings directly. So I applied for that, but I can't think why they turned me down.
Well, I can, but I still think it's a shame. But if I ever get in the DfE, so you'll be my first invite.
They should put you in charge, Jill.
Yeah, yeah, well, they should put us in charge. I always say that, though, but, you know, that's never going to happen. So, but I always used to say that, you know, obviously, if everybody were like me, that would be a disaster. But, you know, because you need difference and diversity, don't you? So I wouldn't expect to pack my table of decision makers to be all like me. You know, I'd want a diversity. And I think we're both on that. Talking about that, You wrote a list, didn't you, about women writers in education? Yes,
I did. Yeah, I just got so fed up as an author, because I do kind of see myself as probably as an author first, and of seeing book reviews being shared on Twitter where there were 10 books and 9 of them were by blokes and Carol Dweck, because she, yeah, you know, she's allowed. Okay, so I got so fed up with this that I thought, right, I'm going to crowdsource a list. And I just did a shout out, because I've got a bit on my website where it's like lists of 100, I don't actually count, there's probably like 1,000 on there, but 100 female education authors, just so that next time I saw one of those reviews, I could tweet out, here's some women you might like to read. Because we really do, I mean, I was thinking about this the other day, we really do have a situation now where a lot of the voices that are being heard in education in a majority female profession are men. And you think about early years, I mean, early years, I'm absolutely an advocate for more men coming into early year. But when you think about the voices that are
the influencers as well, aren't they? They're the ones that are influencing.
You know, 2% of the profession are male. So, you know, that tells a story, I think. So, yeah, I've got my handy list.
Yeah, well, absolutely. And if everybody should go and read that list. I saw, actually, I was on Twitter the other day, I think it was. And funnily enough, I think it came from a women ed thread because I was curating one day for Vivian or for a few hours. And on the thread, it started with a women ed book written by a woman. And then as it was going down the thread, people were recommending other books. And I was like, I don't think people realise the irony that somebody recommended 10 people that were all male. And I was like, hello. But I didn't say anything, but you know, it's kind
of. It does really tell a tale about whose voice is prioritized. Because it's not necessarily about, you know, is it a good book? Is it not a good book? You know, that's not really the question. I mean, if that's the question, then you would look at sales figures and you would think, well, you know, these books have sold more.
Yeah.
But it's about, you know, whose voice do I tune into? And speaking of somebody who writes on behaviour, you know, very few female voices are kind of renowned around behaviour.
Yeah, I wrote a blog because the behavior group was once, do you remember, it was 10 males and 2 females, and I remember writing, you know, wait till your father comes home, because that was the what I called my blog, because that was kind of that old-fashioned idea that only men can do behavior in schools, which is utter nonsense, actually.
I mean, that is a real, you know, that ever since I've been in teaching, that there's definitely an undercurrent of that, isn't there? You know, we'll send them to the bloke, they'll sort them out.
They'll sort the behaviour out. And so, yeah, so I remember my blood boiling when I saw that they'd kind of got these 10 people, where actually there's incredibly, you know, in fact, the best behaviour people I've seen, I think probably in my 25 years in teaching, have been women. So, you know, so that is something. Yeah, it's those gender stereotypes, isn't it, which we talk about a lot and have a bit of a laugh with our gendered with the gendered cheese and things, but it's frighteningly true, unfortunately. But that phrase though, isn't it? I think my mum used to say it, actually. Wait till your father gets home. I challenged her on it, obviously, now. It was like, she was regretting it because my dad would come home and go, I'm not dealing with her. Okay, so again, going back, so which women have inspired you for International Women's Day? What are your women, your sheroes?
I'm going to start with my mum, who, bless her, she lives on her own, so it's not been easy this last year for her. And the reason she kind of inspired me was because, you know, she brought us up alone. She never kind of gave up where something was difficult. So when I was dancing, it was very difficult for her to afford it. And she used to sew all my costumes for me. So she was a real kind of role model for me in terms of, you know, not giving up, both in terms of your family, but also intellectually. So I would say my mum. I would say my friend on Twitter, who I know in real life as well, Laura Henry Elaine.
Oh, she's great, isn't she?
She's fantastic. She recently got an honour at the New Year's Honours, which was amazing.
Is it Jojo and Gran Gran?
Yeah.
Her books, yeah.
And the great thing about Laura is she tells me to, you know, she says to me, it's not boasting if you can back it up. And that little voice in my ear, together with the 10% braver thing, allows me to kind of sometimes retweet a compliment.
that's a really nice one, isn't it? It's not boasting, because I think, again, women do not like to boast, do they? Women do not like to, you know, go, oh, that old thing, oh, I was just lucky, and actually we do need to. I like that, boasting, if you can back it up.
And then I would say probably my third one would be the person I dedicated this book to. And her name is Lynn Wilmot.
I'm just opening it up.
She's on the very first, the dedication. Oh, yeah. This book is dedicated to Lynn Wilmot. Thanks for having me along for the ride. So 10 years ago, when I got involved with preschool, basically from that point onwards, I was sort of working in tandem with Lynn. And we've kind of developed it. So we've developed a forest club, we developed an outdoor area, we built a garden together. So we did so much together. I mean, really sadly, she's actually left the profession now to go and do other things. And that's something that really worries me about early years, is that it relies on this kind of army of very low paid, very undervalued, and I'm talking outside of schools here, women who are on minimum wage, basically, and who are paid term time only, and who just keep the whole of the childcare system together in this country, essentially. So Lynn's been a real inspiration. She's one of these people who, she's a bit like you, Jules, in that she's very strong sort of personality, and assertive, but in a really kind of nice way, that she makes people come with her, even though she can be a bit kind of, you know, she's got a bit of a fire to her. But she brings people with her. And so I think Lynn has been a real inspiration to me.
Oh, that's a great one. Oh, and I feel very honoured, even though I need to meet her now. So. To say, brilliant, thank you. And I, as now I've named you patron of Women Ed, which is completely, I've just decided, you know, I'm like impulsive. What message have you got for women who might be watching and who, for either for various reasons, are not feeling particularly brave? Either they're having a bad time in school, or they're just generally exhausted, or whatever. What message would you give them?
Oh, it's a really hard time at the moment. And I think I would bear in mind that actually we are all going through something together that is just completely, you know, it's like nothing any of us have experienced in our lifetimes, and hopefully won't again. So I think it's almost inevitable that things are going to feel difficult at the moment. And often in my kind of life, I have found that where I've kind of reached an impasse, I've got to a point where don't really feel like I'm driving forwards anymore. Sometimes what I've needed to do, in fact, all the time what I've needed to do, is to kind of do this thing of leaping, but leaping sideways. So I think sometimes, as, I don't know if it's a female thing, maybe not actually, I think we can get stuck into this almost like it's a one track thing, and we're on this track and we mustn't come off it. But actually sometimes, like, I'm just thinking of the example of when we took our kids out of school to avoid SATs and just went traveling for 6 months. And, you know, I got a book out of it, as always. But it's that thing of sometimes the best thing to do is to just do something that feels like it might be a real kind of leap of faith. There's a wonderful quote that I keep coming back to. I suspect I put it in the Women Ed book. And it's by a lady called Cynthia Highmore, who I don't even know who she is. She's American. And she says, the quote goes something like this. If in doubt, just leap. There is a microscopically thin line between behaving like the biggest idiot on the planet and being brilliantly creative. So if in doubt, just go for it. And the thing about it, this has always stood me in really good stead. So we've lived overseas twice in our family's lives. And, you know, at the end of the day, you go, you can just turn around and come back. Which is the first time round that we ended up having to come back quite quickly. And, you know, nothing, sometimes you take that leap and all the things that you imagine might go wrong, actually, they're completely irrelevant, you know? What's the worst that can happen, you know?
Yeah, I like that idea as well of leaping sideways, possibly. You know, I think that's very relevant to, resonates with me, because I do that quite a lot.
I leap
sideways a lot. And it is not necessarily thinking that you have to leap forwards, but you have to leap. So maybe wherever you leap, it doesn't matter if it's forwards or sideways. I like that. Or even backwards, maybe, for if it's a positive, isn't it? But it's a leap, it's a shift.
And if there's something in you that you think, oh, wouldn't it be wonderful if I could, you know, because I remember before writing my first book, wouldn't it be wonderful if I could write a book? And then I thought, well, hang on a sec, just sit down and bloody write one then. Don't sit around going, wouldn't it be wonderful if I lived abroad? Wouldn't it be wonderful if you have to, you know, because they always say, you know, on your deathbed, you're not going to be going, oh, I wish I hadn't. You're going to be going, I wish I had.
Yeah.
So, you know, some of those things that come into your mind, just do them. Leap. Mm. What happens? What's the worst that can happen?
Yeah.
You know, you turn around and come back.
I love that. I love that. Okay, so I'm just going to have, this is my last sort of question before we kind of wrap up and invite Vivian and Palm to come in. But it's, I've got a very dear friend who's early years and in a special school, but and she's wonderful, but what's terrifying her is Ofsted looming. And so I said to her, I'm interviewing, you know, very educational influencer today. That's the new term, isn't it? Thought leader. And I'm going to ask her what message, you know, so what is your advice to early years professionals that are terrified about Ofsted, but really believe in child-centered learning and, you know, following their own values, but are just sort of at that stage, maybe where they're just a little bit like, what do I do?
I think the thing I would say, Jules, I mean, it's kind of easy for me to say this because I'm a volunteer. And to be quite frank, if they sacked me, it would free up a hell of a lot of time for me. So to an extent, you know, it's kind of easy for me to say it. But I think we should all do this. I think we should forget about Ofsted. I think if what you're doing, if your provision arises out of wanting to do the best for every child, then thinking about Ofsted is a distraction. And this current framework, it in theory gives you the opportunity to express, you know, why I'm doing this, how I chose to take this approach, what the outcome of this is. And if anything comes out of it as a positive, it would be to give people professional confidence. So the ability to say, regardless of whether or not Ofsted were going to come and look at this, I would do it because I believe it is genuinely in the best interests of the children. And then Ofsted becomes an irrelevance. And, you know, I sort of say this to people in school-based settings sometimes, but it's quite telling. In the olden days, Ofsted used to literally just turn up in PVI. You didn't get any notice at all. And I remember one day going into preschool and there was a lady I didn't recognise standing outside, and it was the Ofsted inspector. And we just did what we do every day. And at the end of the day, you know, I think this quest for outstanding can be really damaging. And, you know, we think we're not getting sucked into it, but then you see the banners up, don't you? We're good with outstanding features, or we're outstanding. And we've kind of avoided that. And by avoiding making Ofsted a big thing, it almost becomes an irrelevance. We're not doing anything for Ofsted. We are literally doing it for the children. And Ofsted are welcome to come in and have an opinion on it, but their opinion is, you know, it's not why we're doing it. It's easy for me to say that in our context. And obviously, if you're working in a school, which is a really challenging context, because we all know, don't we, that the inequity in society is reflected in an inequity in outcomes from Ofsted inspection.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, there's an extent to which some settings have to play the game a little bit, but I think you will drive yourself mad trying to do the right what Ofsted want, and you'd be better off being professionally confident that you're doing the right thing for the children.
Yeah. Oh, that's a great message. And I hope we all, in whatever school, actually, you know, it's primary, secondary, special schools, alternative provisions, and early years, will take that message back. So, Sue, it's been an absolute pleasure having you. And I'm so honoured that you agreed to come. And actually, it's lovely having Samina here, because Samina was my first audience with. So you're my second, and hopefully long live it. And we'll have some more wonderful women on here. But Palm and Vivian have arrived because, and this is probably going to go horribly wrong now, but we were going to try and sing.
Oh, God.
So before we do try and sing I Am Woman, Hear Me Roar, the story, just to remind everybody, especially if they weren't here at the beginning, well, you tell us the story. So you had written...
A nice way to finish my keynote that I wrote in a drunken haze the night before would be to finish with a poem. So I looked for a song and I thought, I remember because my mum used to play it. That's why I know that song really well. Helen Reddy, this song, I Am Woman. And I was going to read it out. And bloody Vivian shouted, 10% braver. Sing it, Sue. And it's like, I can't effing sing. And I was stood there in front of all these people I'd never met before in my life, having to sing.
You did sing. Now we've all got our hairbrushes or our microphones. Okay.
That's a good plan.
So we've got hairbrushes and microphones.
I have a magic wand instead.
A magic wand. Now we may have to just ad lib this, but I am gonna try and share my screen. And I'm really, really hoping that I might be able to share a screen. Oh, I can't. That's annoying, isn't it? Share complete.
Have you not got the mute? Have you not got Helen Reddy actually singing it, though, so nobody can hear us? Because I can't sing.
Well, I did. That's the thing. I had it. Hang on a minute. Okay, right.
I'm like you, Sue. I couldn't have done what you did at all.
I had it on the YouTube.
If you'd given me some warning, I probably would have, you know, not been quite so hungover.
Samina's just said it was an awesome moment at that
It
first
was.
Event.
It was a brilliant moment, but it hasn't worked. See, I knew this would happen. I practiced this. This is 10% braver. Look, I've got Helen Reddy. We might be able to hear it, even if we can't see it.
I can see it. But I just can't sing it.
That's fine. Can you see the YouTube then, the clip? Or not?
No. I can't. You probably didn't tick the thing that says video somewhere
just,
or other.
Just play the music.
Oh, I know.
Then, Jules.
See, I knew. I thought.
Should I just do a solo?
Right,
I mean, my voice is so terrible.
Now.
Palm's a good singer. She's
you might
going
have
to join
to.
Let Palm do a solo.
No, I
She's
don't even
got
know.
The headphones.
Because I really don't even know the words.
In numbers.
Right, can you hear that?
No, that's me.
No.
Oh, it's you. I thought it was my YouTube. That's how brilliant you are. Right, come on then. Let's just do it.
Then?
So we'll need... Samina, I had been practicing and hang on a minute. Do you know what? Sorry, I keep saying hang on. Let me try sharing again. I'm not giving up. I'm not giving up. Right, hold on. It says page. Oh, this is typical, isn't it? It says page unresponsive. How annoying is this? Right, okay. If not, I've got it on my phone, so I might just play it down my phone. Okay, sorry about this. I'm so disappointed because I had all this ready and I was very excited, but we might just have to sing it anyway.
It's always
so,
the way.
Vivian and Palm, have a chat with Sue. Tell her how wonderful you are while I'm waiting.
Did you ask Sue my question, Jules? Did you ask
your question, Vivian? Was it about the handcuffs?
Oh, yes.
I can't give too much detail. I'll get murdered by my...
hang on a minute.
Oh, this looks promising.
Is the kitchen with a new boyfriend?
That sounded
right. Is this gonna work? So it's going round, isn't it? Right. Okay.
Here we go.
I had a lovely time there.
It's a great song, isn't it? It always makes me
strong. I love that. Okay, well, it was
conversation you had. Like, this whole thing has just been just gorgeous to listen to.
I've still got my hairbrush. Like, I'm still singing. Well, it's been an absolute ball. Vivian.
I borrowed a microphone from my partner and he said, oh my God, you are not going to subject them to hearing you sing. I said, no, I'm just going to pretend.
I just love it. Do you know, I do play that song sometimes in my kitchen, and I run it. I literally dance around the kitchen going, I am strong, I'm invincible. And my kids look at me like I'm completely loony, but I love it.
No comment, Jules.
Somebody's threatening to email this recording around the world. We need to nobble that person.
Just to let, yeah, anybody was watching, that secret does not leave this. We might clip the recording to the end. You know, this does not leave the Zoom room.
What's done in the Zoom room?
Hi, Angeline. Lovely you joined us.
Hello, Angeline. Well, thank you, everybody, for joining us. And thank you again, Sue, for joining us. It's been a blast, as always.
It's been brilliant. Thank you very much.
And Palm and Vivian, thank you for joining in. I think we're like literally the Spice Girls.
Yeah, new career. Oh, there you go, Jules.
That's the unconference, isn't it? The next one.
There's probably scouts watching, thinking, these four women, wow.
Yeah, wow, and not the way that we're thinking, though.
So with my hairbrush, I will thank you all. Thanks, everyone, for coming and sign us all off. And I hope it won't be the last one.
Hope to see you soon, Jules.
Definitely. And what would be lovely, darling, is if you can come to a real life one again sometime. Yay! When all this is over. Have a lovely evening, everybody. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you. Thanks for coming.
Bye.
Bye.